Today, we're going to be speaking with Gerrit Bruhaug, who's a PhD candidate at the University of Rochester, working at the Laboratory of Laser Energetics, the largest university laser lab and one of the only places in the world that can do laser-driven fusion experiments. Gerrit, really great having you on today. I appreciate it.
Yeah, happy to come on, David.
So I want to talk about this recent breakthrough that's made a lot of news in the field of fusion energy. Before we even get to that, let's maybe develop an understanding of what we mean when we say fusion energy. I think for a lot of people, it's sort of straightforward to understand. Okay, you can take something like coal and you burn it, and then you can use that heat to do different things. I think many people can understand that, or you burn gasoline in your car. When we're talking about fusion energy, what exactly is it? What are we talking about? What's the mechanism?
Yeah, so fusion is one of the two primary forms of nuclear energy that we can acquire. Right now, what we do all over the world, in fact, what's keeping my lights on right now is fission, where we split very heavy things like uranium and utilize the heat to boil water, turn a turbine, and make power to power our homes. Fusion is what powers the sun. It's also what powers our largest thermonuclear weapons. It's where we take very small atoms like helium and force them together. That generates an enormous amount of energy. And we have never been able to do a controlled, sustained fusion chain reaction on Earth without a thermonuclear weapon until last week or 2 weeks ago.
So fusion is the coming together of atoms in order to produce, is it accurate to say to produce heat?
It produces several forms of energy, but everything will eventually just get converted to heat to boil water or heat up gases or something like that. It's kind of the old adage that no matter what humanity does, we eventually boil water.
Right. Okay. So in other words, fission is the separation of atoms, whereas fusion is the combination. That's sort of the fundamental difference we're talking about.
Yes.
So the breakthrough, which you alluded to at Lawrence Livermore National Lab in California, it's being described as a huge advancement towards nuclear fusion. What exactly is it that happened?
Yeah, so it is a really big scientific achievement. It's a huge advancement. It's been the goal, essentially, ever since we discovered fusion to get a fusion chain reaction in the laboratory. So humanity has generated fusion chain reactions. We did it first in the 1950s with the Ivy Mike thermonuclear weapon, and now it's some of our scariest weapons. But that is not useful. That is just a capability we have. We want fusion on a small scale, controllable, so that we can make clean sources of power. And that has been very, very challenging to do. And what Lawrence Livermore National Labs did was they generated a self-sustained fusion chain reaction in the lab. No nuclear bombs, no gigantic destruction. Everything was controlled and done and is repeatable. And that has never been done before. So it is a huge advancement. It's kind of like a Kitty Hawk moment. The airplane has finally taken off.
What would it look like to use this technology to generate the energy that humans use for day-to-day lives? Do we know what a fusion power plant would look like?
Yeah, there's a lot of different designs using lots of different technologies. There's a huge plethora of ideas for how to use fusion once you can get ignition, which is what Livermore did. For your average person, it's going to look just like a fission power plant. It'll be just a big chunk of concrete that will make an enormous amount of power for the amount of land it takes up. There will be no CO2, and you might see some clouds coming out from the cooling water, and that would be about it.
So with our traditional, is it fair to say that our traditional nuclear power plants, these are what we would call fission nuclear power plants?
Yes, that's accurate. They split atoms, and thus they do fission.
At those plants, one of the concerns that exists is what do you do with the spent fuel and how long it lasts, et cetera. Now, I've said before, I think that those who are basing their opinion on nuclear fission based on 40-year-old plants are probably not accurately assessing them based on what modern plants would look like. But putting that issue aside for a second, you still have this issue of the spent fuel. In a fusion plant, what are the source materials and what's left over after the fact?
So the source material is some special forms of hydrogen, but it's something that's in the glass of water I'm drinking from right now called deuterium. So that's heavy hydrogen. It's very common. It's not a big deal. It's used in all sorts of applications, primarily nuclear, but even in medical tracers. And we have effectively an infinite supply of it. It would, you know, the sun will be long burnt out before we ever burn through the deuterium supply. The type of fusion that Lawrence Livermore did, which is the quote unquote easiest fusion, is still very, very hard, is called deuterium tritium. So the other input is a special type of radioactive hydrogen called tritium. We have to breed that via lithium. So from the perspective of an outside observer, ignoring all the science, the plant will eat deuterium, which we just get from water, and a small amount of lithium. Now we get concerns about lithium supplies because of electric cars and things like that. We're talking like 100 kilos of lithium a year for a power plant that could power a major city. It's not a wow. It's not a major concern. It's just like with fission, where the total amount of material going in and out is just minuscule. There is no direct nuclear waste. There's no spent fuel from fusion. It just makes helium. But it also makes an absurd number of neutrons, which is a type of radiation, and it will make the inside of the reactor radioactive. There is no way to get around radioactive waste. Anytime we do any kind of nuclear activities, including medicine, every hospital generates a large flux of radioactive waste, but it's a benefit. It's cancer treatment and therapies and all this good stuff. And we know how to handle the waste from these sorts of systems. Fusion would not generate the very long-lived spent fuel. As you pointed out, we can handle the spent fuel from fission, but ignoring that, fusion won't generate it. We're talking things more like 100 years of radioactive lifetime, and there's ideas for how to even shorten that. So that is one of the big advantages that people point to with fusion.
What are the risks of this technology applied as a power plant, for example, to power a city, as you mentioned? What can go wrong? And if something goes wrong, what happens?
In some sort of kind of absurd worst case scenario, you could have radioactive material released to the environment. It would be small. It would be, the impact would be very low. The general issues would be things to people at the plant, very similar to what's happened with fission failures. If you worked at the plant, you'd be worried. You might have to fight a fire or something like that. Often fusion power plants are envisioned to use very interesting, weird coolants. So you imagine like flowing super hot liquid lithium. I'm not so afraid of the radiation. I'm afraid of flowing liquid lithium getting into the air, because that will make a very nasty fire. But these are all, you know, the fusion is going to be regulated just like fission. It's going to be very, very tightly controlled. And everyone takes this job very seriously as to how it would be put together. I would be more than willing, just like I'm willing to live right now, right next to a fission plant, I wouldn't have any concern living next to a fusion plant.
Right now, if my understanding is still accurate, it takes somewhere between 6 and 10 years to get a new nuclear fission plant up and running. What is the timeline? And maybe it's hard to say because we don't yet exactly know what these would look like, but is there a different timeline for fusion energy plants?
There is hope that it could be sped up, but I honestly think the sort of things that would speed up a fusion plant construction will speed up fission construction as well. Mm. A lot of the issues that we see with fission come down to just some of the dumbest stuff, like pouring concrete and laying steel. Fusion requires a lot more complex equipment too. So it's going to be many iterations of learning how to build these power plants before we ever get good at it. It's not something I would expect to see, even if everything was ready to go tomorrow. I wouldn't expect to see power plants just going up left and right without massive, honestly, government support. You have to look at how places like France did their large fission build outs. You just have to throw tons of money and personnel at it.
When you look at something like, or let me put it a different way. When you talk about this being difficult, fusion being difficult, what does that really mean in the sense that as an outsider, in my mind, it seems to me that once you figure out what you need in terms of equipment and you do it, you do it. Now you can replicate it. Is there some chance to it where you can do the exact same thing and it only works some of the time at this point?
So we are on, we have just gotten ignition at Lawrence Livermore. Arguably, we got it last year, but we don't need to quibble about all of that. What it is we're there now, but we're only just barely getting there. And if you've ever played around with something like doing a science experiment where you're just figuring it out, there's often mistakes and issues, and you just kind of have to do something over and over and over again to learn how to do it better. But by difficult, what I'm actually getting at with fusion is that the conditions needed to make a fusion reaction happen are very, very, very hard to reach. Mm. And the equipment required is very expensive and complicated. When we're comparing to other sources of power, like let's just take fission for an easy example. You take a rock that we dig out of the ground, turn it into a metal, stick it into water, and the water gets hot. For fusion, we have to have some of the largest lasers in the world hitting little tiny targets, or massive, incredible magnets that there's just nothing to compare to. Now, that's not to say we can't get good at that. I mean, jet engines used to be one of the most complicated and incredible things on the planet that only militaries could afford. And now all of us can ride on a jet aircraft. Aircraft themselves used to be something that almost no one could build. But we're kind of at the Kitty Hawk moment. We just got things to go. We're not getting 747s tomorrow. But that's not to say they won't happen.
If we zoom out a little bit, the feeling seems to be growing that in even as little as 50 years, we're going to look at the status quo of cars driving around burning gasoline, pulling oil out of the ground, burning coal. This is going to seem crazy, for lack of a better term, right? I mean, it seems as though what we are, the forms of energy we're using now are going to seem almost primitive compared to what is apparently on the horizon. Is that the right assessment?
Yeah, I would say so. I mean, we already have a lot of options that make what's currently powering most of the world look primitive, right? We can already utilize things like nuclear fission. We have, you know, good photovoltaic stuff like that. The sci-fi technology is here, and it's only getting better.
When people say that fusion power is the holy grail of clean energy, this is based on emissions specifically, or are there other aspects to this too?
The reasoning behind that, and I'm not entirely sold on that statement.
Okay.
I've heard it plenty of times. I think it comes from a kind of science fiction optimism around fusion, and a lack of understanding, or maybe not a lack, but a naivete over some of the other sources. Fusion is emissions free. The fuel supply is effectively infinite. Like I said, it doesn't matter. There's so much. We don't even need to worry about it. Those are the big benefits on top of the lower radioactive waste inventory. But what I just described is basically advanced fission as well. And so I think that's kind of where it doesn't always click. It's this idea that if we got to fusion, then all our problems are solved. But that's not really true. One, like I said, it's going to be hard to get these things out and cheap and effective and reliable. But we have options now that can reach a lot of those goals. Fusion, in my mind, is more of filling in this large portfolio of various energy options. Each of them have benefits and, you know, drawbacks. And it's not just this science fiction utopia.
Last thing I want to ask you, what's the next step? Is it just to repeat this very same thing that happened, or is there some clear advanced next step that we go to?
So the immediate next step is to repeat and get more fusion yield. We think, due to how ignition works, it's like striking a match. Once you can get the match to strike, you can get more and more fire. We think we can get a lot more fusion out of the Livermore facility. So they're going to work on that as hard as possible. But there's already designs for how to build the next laser facilities to push this forward. And there's other fusion concepts that are being worked on, other reactors. But everyone can use the fact that we lit the match to study how that match is lit.
Right.
And to build these next step machines. I expect we'll see many machines reaching ignition in the next 10 years. And then we can really start to evaluate what's the best way to move forward for power.
Or super things interesting. Like
space propulsion.
Which is a whole other aspect to it also. Yeah, that relates to the idea of going to Mars and connects with so many other things that are going on. Fascinating stuff. We've been speaking with Gerrit Bruhaug, who's a PhD candidate at the University of Rochester. Gerrit, really appreciate your time today. Thank you.
Yeah, thank you so much.